taking time both for introduction and allowing me to visit. I chose to come in March because I'm told it's kind of springtime. I've been saying to people it's about 25 degrees warmer where I come from. So it's been a bit of a shock to the system. What I would like to see a second is to get my equipment coming up. So I thought that before I kind of get to the essence of the paper, I should just say a few things about the history workshop so that you can locate what I'm going to say in the kind of intellectual history of the history workshop in order to have some sense of where I come from intellectually. And you may want to ask some questions about what that means and how it impacts on the analysis that I'm going to be presenting here. So the history workshop was established in 1977 in the wake of the Soweto uprising in 1976. And some of the founding members of the history workshop, particularly Phil Bonner and others, were also involved in the emerging black trade movement. For those of you who are slightly older than me will know that this workshop comes after the late 1960s kind of student movements in Europe and was inspired by E.G. Thompson relating to the English working class. And essentially what that attempted to do was to kind of challenge dominant historiography and insert more centrally into the historiography the experiences of what we now call the subaltern, but in particular the histories of the working class. In the South African context, what that meant specifically was to challenge, in the first instance, the kind of very narrow, racialized histories of the apartheid government, and kind of disrupt that by uncovering, archiving, and rewriting the history of South Africa from the experiences of the black working class, and particularly the black working class in industrial areas, so the struggles of the working class, and in making kind of trade unions and the labor movement more generally, but also to rewrite the histories of black communities from the vantage point of those communities. A key methodology in trying to achieve that was, of course, oral history. Some of you may know that Jan Vaccino passed away recently, and the kind of that kind of tradition of oral history. So the history workshop has been doing this for the past 40 years, and has probably played a kind of key role in rewriting South African history from this vantage point. More recently, we have kind of moved outside of the main metropolitan areas. And as Marcus said in introducing me, the chair that I have is kind of entitled Local Histories, Present Realities. And it's an attempt to kind of cast our intellectual and research and public history beyond the metropolitan areas. Because even though a significant amount of work has been done in reimagining the history of South Africa, most of that work has been done in the metropolitan areas. So we're kind of going beyond the Johannesburg, Cape Town, and Durban into the interior and trying to understand the kind of local dynamics of small towns, but also how those small towns articulate with the urban, with the rural areas, throughout the 20th century, but also try and better comprehend a set of issues that are playing themselves out in New South Africa. Can I ask whoever is kind of chairing to let me know after about half an hour,
okay.
So that I've got my watch here, but I can guarantee you it's kind of fade away, right? So that's just give you a sense of the kind of my intellectual reference point and also the kind of political ambitions behind some of our research. Now, the event that I'm going to be focusing on is the Sharpeville Massacre of March 1960. And this event is regarded as a critical turning point in South Africa's history for a number of reasons. It came at the end of a decade or so of mass mobilization, mainly under the leadership of the ANC, during which time some of the key figures in the national movement, like Nelson Mandela, O.R. Tambo, and a range of others, rose to prominence and imposed themselves as the kind of key leaders of the liberation movement. This was a kind of the key decade that established the ANC and leaders of the ANC as the key figures in the liberation movement. The Sharpeville Massacre comes at the end of this. And it is regarded as perhaps the main turning point in the history of the liberation movements and also of apartheid, which had been established in 1948, although segregation goes back, of course, in much longer than the advent of apartheid. And it's a turning point for perhaps two or three key reasons. First of all, a few weeks after the massacre, and 69 people were killed by the police at Sharpeville, the ruling party banned the ANC, the African National Congress, and the and as a consequence of the banning of these organizations, both the ANC and PAC turned to the armed struggle in 1961. And therefore, the Sharpeville Massacre is seen as the kind of inaugural moment of a new kind of struggle against apartheid, the armed struggle. Linked to that, the Sharpeville Massacre also marked the kind of assertion of white dominance, of white control, and particularly of security apparatus. So that repression of the political organizations, but of black people in general, was intensified in the 1960s through various pieces of legislation and the securitization of the state apparatus. Thirdly, it inaugurated a period that has been defined as the golden era of apartheid. So even though immediately after the Sharpeville Massacre, many Western countries threatened to disinvest from South Africa, in fact, within a year or so, that trend was reversed, and there was massive new investment into South Africa by the United States and Britain in particular, but also other countries. That contributed to South Africa being the second fastest growing economy after Japan in the 1960s. So for all sorts of reasons, this was a kind of a key moment. A lot of the literature on the Sharpeville Massacre has focused, as you can hear me kind of saying, on what happened in Sharpeville. Now before I go on to kind of setting up my key argument, and this is where my kind of historians' Luddite tendencies has come into play, because I don't have a kind of what you call this thing, a slide, right? I can project over there and show you what I'm talking about. But I'm hoping that some of you will have a sense of where Johannesburg is, right? It is the economic heartland of the country, and the area that I'm talking about is about 60 kilometers south of Johannesburg. And Johannesburg is at the center of a province now known as Gauteng Province, the province of gold, because of gold mining. And the area that I'm talking about is at the southern tip of this province. It has historically been an important industrial region, first coal mining and then steel. And it's a center, it was a center of the steel industry for about 50 years. And it's located on a river. And the kind of key town in this area is called Vereeniging. It's the white town to which Sharpeville is attached. Now, that geography is only marginally important. But what I, the reason why I titled the paper Baal Burning is important for a number of reasons. Because Sharpeville is one of four black locations in the Baal area. And what the Sharpeville Massacre does, this is my kind of, my first, the first main point of my argument. What the Sharpeville massacre has done, and because of its importance in the historiography and the political history of South Africa, the attention has always been focused on what happened in the hour or so before the police shot and killed 69 people. Scores of other people were, of course, injured, and most of the people were shot in the back, you know, as they ran away from the police. And you know, the police opened fire and killed and maimed several people. So the literature on Sharpeville has focused on kind of two or three things. One, as I just said, now what happened the hour or so before the massacre. And there's an important book by someone called Philip Frankel that looks at the kind of policing methods and what happened in the kind of minutes before a policeman shot and kind of caused the subsequent mayhem. Secondly, there has been some debate, and this is really the kind of one of the important kind of reference points for this paper. There has been intense debate and contestation between the ANC and the PAC about who owns Sharpeville. And of course, this becomes important, as Mark alluded to in his introduction. It becomes important in the kind of production of dominant narratives, of a kind of national historiography. It's important for the ANC to have claimed to play the key role, because Sharpeville, like 1976, is regarded as one of the kind of the key milestones in the shaping of South Africa's history, and in particular, the kind of glorious history of liberation, in which the ANC has claimed to be the predominant party, which it is important for the ANC to claim, because of course it lends legitimacy to its current rule, and the argument that it makes, as all kind of ruling parties make, that its legitimacy comes from its role in the liberation movement, and therefore it should remain unchallenged, and therefore it should remain in power. The PAC is a much smaller party today than it was, you know, 60 odd years ago, when it broke away from the ANC and criticized the ANC on a number of key political points. One, 5 years before the Sharpeville massacre, the ANC adopted what was called the Freedom Charter that set out a kind of fairly radical economic plan that was kind of influenced by the Communist Party, but was by and large a kind of radical social democratic program. One of the key elements in that program was a vision of non-racial unity in South Africa, of non-racialism. The Pan-Africanist Congress critiqued the ANC for its adherence to non-racialism and for foregoing the kind of Africanist impulses that animated the politics of the ANC from the 1940s from the mid-1940s to the mid-1950s. Secondly, it criticized the ANC for one of the kind of programmatic ideas in the Freedom Charter was that South Africa, it says at the beginning, belongs to all living. It's kind of essentially a kind of non-racial idea. The PAC insisted that it gave equal kind of political rights to the land in particular to all people, when in fact it argued that the African people, who are indigenous people, should have first rights over land. Okay? So the PAC split from the ANC on kind of two key issues, the question of non-racialism and the question of the land, critiquing it from an Africanist point of view. So every year since 1994, there have been commemorations in Sharpeville, and it's always a contestation. Every year, the same kind of spectacle happens. They go to the cemetery where the people were buried. The ANC, because it's in power, is able to mobilize enormous resources to kind of, you know, commemorate what's happening, and the PAC will organize a counter-demonstration. So Sharpeville, the events at Sharpeville, has been a consistent bone of political and historiographical contention. My argument here is that by focusing on, by having that contestation, and one by kind of the contestation centering around which political party has authority over the events at Sharpeville, And because Sharpeville has been such an important turning point, what has in fact happened is that the events around Sharpeville and understanding the anti-past campaign has been completely ignored. Right? And there are important omissions in the historiography which obscures important processes and therefore understandings of what led to the marches against passes in the Vaal area. I'm sorry, if you don't mind, the people who are recording me, I was saying that it's about, I'm getting very cold, but now I'm getting extremely hot, so I'm just, if you don't mind, and I will, yes please, I will connect myself. I was told to kind of dress in layers, right? I realized that I needed to take the layers off before speaking. Okay. here's the argument, right? The kind of first contention that I want to make is that, in fact, Sharpeville was not at the center of the anti-past rebellion. That the area that was far more important was, in fact, the location of Everton. Thank you very much. And this is important, okay? Let me just kind of, sorry, I'm slightly distracted by having to disrobe. Great, so on the 21st of March 1960, the African population in the Vaal, but also in other parts of the country, Soweto, Pretoria, and Cape Town, mobilized against passes. Now, the passes, I imagine not everyone knows what the passes were, but they were kind of reference books that initially African men had carried, which gave them kind of permission, a permit to be in the urban areas. Because in South Africa, under segregation and apartheid, African people were designated to reserves, a term which I think is familiar to you, to the rural areas, which were regarded as their traditional rural home. If they wanted to move out of those kind of reserves into the urban areas, which were designated as the kind of primary spaces of whiteness and modernity, of privilege and economic power, they needed to carry passes. To be able to enter those areas and particularly to get work. From the mid-1950s, the government also extended passes to African women. Of course, what this meant was that the ability of African people to move around was severely curtailed. They could only move legally to those areas where they were going to find work. Okay? Now, the reason why it was only extended to African women in the mid-1950s is because in 1913, African women in fact protested very successfully against the issuing of passes to African women. But from the mid-1950s, because of apartheid, the government extended the passes also to the African women. And in 1956, about 20,000 African women marched to Pretoria to hand in a petition objecting to the extension of passes. But in fact, notwithstanding that massive march and subsequent struggles, the government was determined to extend the passes to the African women as well. So passes were an affront to the dignity of African people. The fact that African people had to carry a pass to move around in a country of their birth was an important symbol of white oppression of black people. When we interviewed many, many African men, when they talk about passes, they invariably kind of hold left pocket, right? Because that is, they have to carry their passes with them all the time. Kind of every day, if you left your house, if you didn't have your pass, you could be subject to a pass raid. In fact, millions of African men found themselves in prison for varying times from one day to several weeks and years because they didn't have passes. So you can see that the pass books were a source of contention and were kind of mobilized around quite easily. So in late 1959, the PAC broke away from the ANC in 1958, launched itself in April 1959, had its first conference in December 1959, and immediately announced that it would have an anti-past campaign. We'll come back to some of the issues around this. The ANC claims, and this is around the contention of who owns the Sharpeville massacre, the ANC claims that the PAC had usurped the campaign, that it were kind of, they were kind of Johnny come latelys, the ANC had been mobilizing against FASA, which is true. But of course, the PAC had in fact announced its own FASA campaign a few weeks before the ANC. Nonetheless, what was happening across the country was kind of mobilization against FASA's. And Pretoria, parts of Soweto, the Vaal, and parts of Cape Town became the epicenters of the anti-FASA campaign. But I'm zooming in on the Vaal. Give you some sense of the scale of the mobilization. In 1960, the total African population of the Vaal, comprising four townships, was just over 100,000 people. On the day of the march, something like 40,000 people marched against FASA, close to 40% of the population, and probably you know a much bigger proportion of the adult population. In terms of the proportion of people marching from the different townships, more than 50% of the people who marched on the day came from Everton. So, in my view, this kind of these bare statistics kind of disrupt the centrality of Sharpeville. And it requires explanation. And this is really the essence of what I'm doing. So why Everton and what were the anti-FASA campaigns about? So in South African urban history, I think it's important to kind of very briefly state that throughout the 20th century, the one government attempted to corral black people into locations and then townships from the mid-1940s. And these were attempts to, first of all, segregate black people and place them in areas where various technologies of surveillance were imposed on people. Kind of entry points, so your pass, you had to show your pass to the superintendent to have permission to come into the area. If you wanted to move between townships, you had to have an additional permit to give you permission to move between areas, between townships and between urban areas. So there were kind of, and housing was organized as a form of surveillance as well. So the locations and townships increasingly became sites of tight control over the lives of black people, right? Control of black bodies through white oppression and surveillance. And the passes were an important part of the technology of surveillance over black people. Now, there were some exceptions to this. And these were, in particular, freehold areas as well as squatter settlements. In the 1940s, because of massive urbanization, there was a proliferation of squatter settlements, but the state kind of attempted, from the late 40s, to dismantle these squatter settlements and place people in townships. The freehold areas remained for at least up to the 1960s beyond this kind of technologies of surveillance, beyond the townships. So what were freehold locations? They were kind of an aberration, because in 1913, the government enacted the infamous Land Act. And what the Land Act did was it designated 87% more or less of South Africa to white occupation and ownership. The main urban areas, the main farming areas, and so forth. And the majority of the population, African people, were confined to about between 7 and 8%, and it was increased to over 10% of the land, mainly in the old reserves. And what is stipulated was that African people could not own property outside of those designated areas. But before the Act was promulgated in 1913, for a host of kind of complex reasons, some locations were established in the urban areas, such as Alexandra, Everton, Cato Manor, Sophia Town, and so on, where black people were given the right to have freehold title. And so what it meant was that these small areas were not governed directly by the municipalities. They often had their own kind of governance structures, and people were able to live lives that were not free of repression, oppression, and so on, but they were not governed in the same way as other locations. So there was a kind of relative autonomy of all sorts. Okay? African men still needed passes to come into the urban areas. All African men had passes. But the way that these freehold locations were organized meant there were more liberties than in the formal locations, the municipal locations and townships that came into being under apartheid. And this is critically important because in the history of Everton, what one had was a kind of a class one of freehold landowners and entrepreneurial class, but also intellectuals. In fact, there was a college in Everton called Wilberforce College that drew inspiration from a similar movement in the United States. So there's a sense that these freehold locations were exceptional, they were different, they were distinctive from the kind of tightly controlled townships. And there were all sorts of struggles, which I'm not going to go into now, in the 1930s, 1940s, and early 1950s. Of particular significance was that in the early 1950s, the people of Everton embarked on a bus boycott, very similar to the Montgomery bus boycott, which happened around the same time as the Alexander bus boycott of 1956-1957. And this bus boycott lasted for almost a year, and it was around fares and the quality of the buses. So not segregation, because the buses were not even shared. Right? So the buses were only for black people, right? But the conditions were terrible and the fares were high. The people won their demand for lower fares. But what happened in Everton, as it did in Alexandria, was that once this victory was achieved, the central government imposed stricter control over the township. Because basically the government's attitude was, to quote the commission, was that the blacks from Everton were cheating, okay? And they needed to be brought under control. So in Alexandria, where there's also a significant boycott, the government created its own kind of governance structures called the Urban Health Board, and a similar structure was imposed on Everton. What this meant was that for the first time in its history, and Everton was established in the early 1900s, so for more than 50 years it had this kind of relative autonomy. Now the government came down and tried to impose the kind of surveillance that it had imposed on other townships. And therefore the passes became a point of particular grievance in Everton, more so than was the case in places like Sharpeville, which was established in the mid-1940s. And people had become accustomed to the kind of surveillance that was imposed on them, and in fact did not mobilize against this kind of surveillance throughout this period, at least not until 1940. So I think it's important therefore to recognize that the kind of underlying causes for the anti-pass campaign in Everton was much sharper than they were elsewhere in the Vaal and the rest of the country. The second reason is the PAC. Now, often in the literature on the liberation movement, attention is given to the national leaders. So Nelson Mandela looms large, right? And for anyone who's read Nelson Mandela's Long Walk to Freedom, it kind of established the kind of template of liberation historiography. And people kind of insert themselves into that template as if the struggle across the country was orchestrated by a handful of national male leaders. And what tends to happen is that local activists get written out of these kind of dominant narratives, particularly if they come from opposition parties. Now, what happened in Sharpeville, and particularly the two other locations, Bokkelong and Boipatong, was in fact a new generation of African intellectuals and activists was taking shape in the early 1930s. And these tended to be people who were second-generation urbanites, meaning that one, they were more urban, secondly, tended to be more educated, and inevitably because of the college that existed, and therefore had much greater aspirations than previous generations. They were also quite critical of the ANC, which in the mid-1950s, notwithstanding the kind of campaigns that the ANC had been mobilizing, particularly in concert with the Communist Party, that it was clear to them from a pan-Africanist perspective that the ANC was kind of trying to reach some kind of political compromise with the apartheid government. So even in his trial in the early 1960s, Nelson Mandela's vision for South Africa was a kind of partial full franchise. Okay. And I can't remember the exact phrase, but it says something like, you know, we would be satisfied if the franchise was implemented incrementally. Okay. And of course, this comes from a kind of an elitist point of view. So understanding that it could be a limited franchise initially that would lead to a full franchise. So the ANC was prepared, even at its most apparently most radical moments, to kind of strike a deal. Okay, that for the pan-Africanists, the more radical elements, especially the young people, was regarded as a compromise. They were also very critical, as I said earlier, about the retreat from Africanist nationalist politics that had characterized people like Nelson Mandela in the 1940s, but which they believe the ANC had reneged on from the early 1950s. So what one had was a kind of a new generation of young Africanist intellectuals critiquing the ANC. Most of them were, at this point in time, members of the ANC Youth League and were contesting the politics of the ANC. In Edmonton, because of the bus boycott, this kind of layer of activists also cut their teeth in kind of real activism and mobilization of the entire community. So by the late 1950s, one had a cadre of activists who had become very experienced, very critical of the ANC, and were in the forefront of the split of the Africanists from the ANC and in establishing the PAC in 1959, far more than in most other parts of the country. Some of you may know a retired constitutional court judge, Dikgang Moseneke, retired last year, and he comes from that generation. He was 16 when he was in prison and sent to Robben Island in the early 1960s, but Kanting said 5 minutes late. Five more minutes late, okay? But kind of exemplified this kind of generation of young activists. So the second point I'm making about Everton was that you had this kind of layer of activists who were kind of deeply embedded in the community, were very critical of the ANC, and was able to mobilize very quickly when they joined the PAC in the late 1959, and kind of in 2 months, from January 1960, that they were able to mobilize very quickly. Because I have 5 minutes, I'm going to kind of make some points in a very truncated way. The next point I want to make, is that what is often missed in the literature on Sharpeville by both the ANC and the PAC was that the success of the march, meaning the number of people that were brought out into the streets, was in part for the reasons that I've given. But in fact, the main reason is that from 1956, African women were in the forefront of the anti-apartheid campaigns. So there was a kind of ongoing campaign. This was not something that was kind of dreamt up by the PAC or the ANC. Okay? As I said, in 1956, we had 20,000 people marching, 20,000 women marching to Pretoria. In 1957, Quebec, across the country, tens of thousands of African women protested against the extension of passes. They failed to prevent the government from extending the passes, but there was mobilization nonetheless. So, when the ANC claims that this was its campaign, right? It makes a claim on behalf of male leaders asserting kind of authority over a campaign that was in fact led by independent women, okay, independent organizations. Secondly, even the PAC's claim that it kind of inaugurated this movement kind of hides some ugly truths. So for example, in Sharpeville and Everton, the PAC, including these kind of radical young people, issued a leaflet that stated explicitly that women should not be part of the march, right? That what women should be doing is that they should be playing their traditional role. They should stay at home, okay? And that the women must make sure the men go and march, but the women shouldn't be marching, okay? There's a kind of a wonderful story about Nelson Mandela and Winnie Mandela in 1958, the year after they met, okay? Which kind of gives you some sense of how these African male leaders, I mean, you know, the kind of key figures of the ANC, when women protested against the passes, many of them were imprisoned in the fort in Johannesburg. And they went on a hunger strike and they refused to take bail. Okay? The male leaders of the ANC said, no, you've got to come home. You've got to take bail. What? This is too radical for us. What? Who's going to look after us? Right? So you can see there's a kind of important kind of gender dimension, which is kind of missed because the focus is on the kind of national dimensions of the anti-pass campaign, the national significance of Sharpeville. But when one digs deeper, then I think one gets a sense of the different dimensions. Let me make kind of three points finally. The one I'll make very quickly and then spend a couple of minutes on the last two points. Okay. The first is that the shooting of people in Sharpeville happened in the afternoon. So part of what this paper is going to do is it traces what happens from midnight already. Okay? Because in fact the protest happens over kind of 12 to 14 hours. And a lot of these kind of initial protests happen in the other townships and specifically in Everton. So for those of you who know, in Sharpeville people went to the police station, and that is where the shooting occurred. Something similar on a much bigger scale happened in Everton several hours before then. Right? So in fact, it's important to understand the events that led to Sharpeville, but from a local perspective. Right? Because the kind of intensity of the standoff between the police and the black population, but also the white population, what happened was that the whites were armed. Right? As black people marched through the areas, they stood on the verandas, you know, guns in hand, kind of defending their white towns. Okay? In fact, one person was killed hours before the shooting in Sharpeville. So it's a kind of sequence of events. And the Sharpeville is a culmination of what happened rather than the main event. In fact, the main event happened several hours before then. So let me end up on this point, I'll just make it, you can ask me more questions. There are kind of a couple of methodological points. A lot of what I'm doing comes from a kind of uncovering and reorganization of a commission of inquiry that occurred around Sharpeville, right? To inquire about the events at Sharpeville. And only a handful of people have gone through this archive, but in a very disorganized way. So I've spent the last kind of a few months reorganizing that commission of inquiry and kind of engaging all the transcripts of the commission of inquiry. Because what most people have done, the handful of people looked at it, they looked at the report of the commission of inquiry rather than looking at the transcripts that went into the commission of inquiry. So that's this kind of reworking, rereading, comes through a different engagement of the commission of inquiry, keeping in mind, and scholars kind of key phrase, one needs to read this commission of inquiry against the grain, okay? But similarly, also not ignore what happened at the commission of inquiry, through a kind of different reading of the transcripts. Then ultimately, there's a kind of an interesting debate taking place in amongst historians, and that is around the work of commissions of inquiry in kind of producing dominant narratives. Again, some of you may be familiar with the Marikana massacre and the commission of inquiry that sat for 2 years in kind of producing a particular narrative of the Marikana massacre, and something similar happened in 1976. And whenever there's been a kind of key political event or kind of massacre of the sort, the state, both the apartheid state and now the democratic state, kind of has resorted to instituting commissions of inquiry in order to take control of the process of producing narratives. Okay? Part of this work, which will be a separate paper, will be to look at how this commission of inquiry around Sharpeville, produced, did the work of making history in relation to other commissions of inquiry in 76 and also the Marikana massacre. And then finally, a lot of this kind of rewriting is also comes through new interviews that we've done, that I've done with people that have participated in the events at Everton and Sharpeville, which cast a kind of completely different light on the events that occurred there. These kind of two different methodological interventions of a kind of engagement with the Commission of Inquiry, as well as new oral testimonies, allows one to kind of rewrite the events there and decenter Sharpeville and place Everton more centrally in the narrative.
So we're open for questions now. We have, yes,
Diane. I really appreciated your point about African women organizing, and I was wondering if you could just elaborate on the ways that they organized and some of the different protests and activism that they engaged in this period.
So, what's the format? Answer on each question, or
yes.
Okay, right. in a number of ways. Okay, so in the 1950s, there was an organization called the Federation of South African Women that was launched in the mid 1950s and brought together different organizations. The ANC had already launched the ANC Women's League, which was kind of far more loyal to the official line of the ANC, although there were important contestations. FEDSAW, as the name suggests, kind of was a more of a united front of women's organizations. Now, FEDSAW comes about to focus on kind of the big national questions facing women. And in fact, very interestingly, a year before the Freedom Charter was adopted in 1955, FEDSAW launches the Women's Charter. And that sets out quite radical demands for achieving liberation of women and equality. This is 1950, so the idea of equality, feminist ideas are kind of still being contested and kind of worked through. The anti-caste campaign becomes a kind of focal point. But I think that one needs to go back almost 10 years and maybe 20 years, because in the from the mid 1950s. There's a massive increase in the urbanization of African women. But African women remain quite marginalized in urban areas for a host of reasons. There aren't many employment opportunities for African women. So when they get to the urban areas, they have to engage in a range of informal economic activities, including, and perhaps mainly, things like illegal beer brewing and other things. African women also constitute an important part of the kind of squatter population and also for demands for housing and other kind of demands that could be kind of broadly under the umbrella, be kind of defined as rights in the city and rights to the city. Okay? So from the early 1940s, African women are almost constantly in contestation with authorities. And in fact, they play a critical role in the radicalization of African politics in the 1940s that kind of culminates in FEDSAW and carries on into the 1950s. So there's kind of a range of kind of contestations around what we call bread and butter, rights to the city issues, and kind of broader political campaigns. What the ANC has done, again, one can understand this from its kind of political location, is to kind of claim all of those struggles as being part of the ANC. But in fact, most of the struggles kind of occurred outside of formal political organizations, and there were myriad kind of local organizations that kind of didn't all come into the Federation of South African Women, but looked at the Federation of South African Women as a kind of umbrella organization in the 1950s. There's a lot more, but kind of, those are just the highlights. Yeah.
Thank you. I have a related question. So what about the passbook upset women? Like a particular issue about the passbook in the
upset women. Okay. So as with African men, the passes attempted to control the mobility of African people. Okay. What I wanted to say, but forgot to say, and kind of I'll say now that it helps me answer your question differently, is that from the early 1950s, from 1952, the apartheid government attempted, they had defined African women in a number of ways. In the kind of official literature, African women were regarded as kind of loose. Loose models, politically contentious, and so on. And so the state made a concerted effort from the early 1950s to impose much tighter control of African women, because they were politically contentious, but socially loose, right? And they did it in a number of ways. I'll come back to the passes. One, in the new townships, African women could not own houses. What that meant, right, was that they had to be in marriage. They had to be married, right, in order to have access to a house. So the kind of ability to be permanent residents was attached to being married. Of course, right, whatever you might think of the institution of marriage, it was a form of a certain control of African women. Okay? And housing was another kind of technology of surveillance over all African people, but particularly African women. There were various other kind of pieces of legislation that tended to assert greater control over the lives of African women. The passes were designed to impose the same restrictions on African women as there was in African men. And what the passes meant was both control over mobility, but it was also a way for the state to know, right? And in a kind of modernist state thinking, knowing what people do is actually it's critically important. And what the passes did was to kind of say, where you're from, which kind of tribe, which kind of area, and importantly, whether you had work. Okay? So you have a stamp in the book to say that you were employed or not employed. If you weren't employed, you were regarded, I don't know whether this is a familiar term here, as a loafer, right? As a work shy, right? And therefore, if you were not formally employed, you could be ejected from the urban areas back to a rural area. So, for all sorts of reasons, imposed these kinds of controls, and because it was new, the extension of passes to African women was new in the 1950s, there was massive mobilization against it at the time.
Yeah, Jane?
I have two visions as you were speaking, and one is of a photograph in a newspaper of, I think, Sharpeville, and being horrified, and I would have then been early teen, not quite early teens. And then the rise of Soweto. And it made me wonder, as I was listening to you, the role of the press in creating national narratives and how it gets used and not used. And then, because you were also talking about how, you know, international states turn around and say, we're not going to become involved in investment, and yet that so rapidly changes in the 60s. Can you just talk about that?
So I think this is fascinating. This is another paper, right? let me make two or three points, right? The Sharpeville massacre became well known because of the radical media, particularly the liberal media. And when I talk about liberal media, I mean the kind of English-speaking media in South Africa that kind of portrayed it differently from the Afrikaans-speaking media. Okay? So that's the first thing. Secondly, radio. Always been a very important form of media. far more popular than any print media or even television. Okay? And this still remains the case. I mean, millions of people listen to radio in South Africa. So media absolutely played a role. But of course, we're talking the 1960s. I'll come back to 1966 in a minute. And the media, including the liberal media, tended to be pro-government. Okay? So the idea of black people protesting, except for one or two media houses, was kind of strongly opposed and portrayed in a particular way that contributed to this kind of narrative that also came out of the commissions of inquiry. Mm-hmm. So both in Sharpeville and then a few years later, something called the Paarl Uprising, where there was a similar kind of march in a small town in the Western Cape called Paarl. The way that the media portrayed this was basically to kind of portray black people as kind of bloodthirsty, immoral, prone to kind of violence, the kind of representation of the black body, particularly of black males, as being intrinsically violent, okay, and irrational. So these were the kind of the main images. So even though the commission itself found that the vast majority of people killed at Sharpeville were shot in the back, okay, so despite those facts, the portrayal of black people on that day was about kind of, they had these pictures of black people surrounding the police station as if they were going to invade the police station. In fact, what they did was they were handing themselves over to be arrested because they said, we refuse to carry passes, arrest us. Okay. So kind of, very basic passive resistance tactic. Okay. Fast forward to 1976, okay, so you have the kind of iconic image of Hector Peterson being carried, right, by a young man and his sister running next to him. And what that image did was, in fact, within 24 hours, spread the rebellion because of this image. And within a day, the whole country knew what was happening. And in fact, if that wasn't the case, what happened in 76 may be very, very localized. That is important because of that image. But what also happened in 76, this becomes a surprise to Canadians, okay? Television was only introduced in South Africa in 1975, okay? Because of the apartheid government thought that the devil was in television. They were probably right. So television was only introduced in 1975. So when the rebellion happened in 76, of course, this images of what was going on here was kind of spread across the country. Most black people didn't have television, but you could see the images, it was there. Right? So certainly media played a role both in the case of 76 of kind of spreading the news of what happened, but there was a far more sympathetic liberal media in 1976 and compared to 1960s. So that in fact what happens is that the state clamps down on black media and the liberal media. Editors are arrested in 76, 1977, because increasingly the liberal media, and of course black media is already anti-apartheid, but they begin to clamp down on them because it becomes spaces of dissent, even kind of more liberal framework.
Thank you.
Yeah,
Sanova.
Yeah. Hi,
and
then
I'll
so this very interesting talk. My question is actually more related to contemporary times, especially in light of the fact that with 2-3 years ago, the South African gold miners' strike or the Rhodes Fall movement that went on last year, a lot of people have noted that it's really mostly led by trade unionists. So I was wondering how that memory that you talk about between ANC and white supremacist competing narratives, where do trade unionists use this local moment in Sharpeville to talk about contemporary resistance? And the other question, or rather observation I thought that was interesting about your presentation was that a lot like Akhil Manley's theory of necropolitics, which is about how violence against black bodies is essential to white supremacy capitalism, and the capitalist logic of white supremacy is often thrown out the window when we talk about race politics. I thought it was very interesting the way you talk about that, but I also thought that the way you talk about surveillance, I was wondering if you can elaborate some thoughts about that, because the system of the past, as you said, is something that Canadians are familiar with, like keeping people in reserves, asking for something. And even the history of the modern passport, like which I think historians like John Seville have talked about, is also that formatting of recognizing which bodies are recognized, which bodies are desirable, which bodies are not desirable. I was wondering if you can elaborate more on what is the link between Mumbai's necropolitics and surveillance, and how do they work together in serving the logic of white supremacist capitalism?
So let me answer the first one pretty quickly, because it's very interesting, right, that in all kind of political movements, there's always a kind of a certain claims are made about connections to the past. The past is kind of mobilized behind particular political agendas, and that has happened in South Africa. But in kind of very interesting ways. The Roads Must Fall movement, or Peace Must Fall movement, I'm working on another paper around kind of generational imaginations, kind of drawing on some Caribbean literature, particularly David Scott's work on kind of imagining different generational imaginations. And the Peace Must Fall movement kind of draws on 76, while at the same time critiquing the 76 generation as having sold out the promise of freedom. So there's this kind of interesting kind of dilemma in the way young people relate to the past, and how the generation that kind of produced freedom is invested in the present and also relates to the past differently. So I'm kind of raising that as a context, because in fact trade unionists have largely been absent in this. Okay? So the platinum strike in 2012 was a kind of key moment that led to the kind of reconfiguration of organization of mine workers, particularly in the platinum sector, and was perhaps the kind of the kind of key moment that has led to some reconfiguration of the trade union movement, particularly the expulsion of the Metal Workers Union from COSAT, which was the main federation linked to the ANC. And the Metal Workers Union, with about 50 other unions, are about to launch a new trade union federation the next week. So you have this kind of reconfiguration of the trade union movement, but what in fact has not happened by and large is that trade union movement kind of making any claims about its own history. It's a kind of, it's peculiar from the outside, although South Africa has experienced a kind of an amplified sense of presentism. Okay? There's a kind of an aversion to engaging the past. And with the constant claims on the past, there's also reluctance to kind of engage it too much. And that has to do with the kind of dispensation, the way the kind of Rainbow Nation was constructed, the way the TRC dealt with the past as kind of dealing with the trauma of the past and closing the book, and kind of insisting that the South Africans should look forward and rather than kind of engage the trauma of the past. That's a kind of a general answer, but one or two kind of specific comments. There is a growing literature in South Africa that is beginning to kind of look at, and particularly in the last few years, where for a host of reasons, young black scholars and young black activists have placed the kind of politics of the black body more centrally into kind of activist politics and in the academy. So what one is beginning to see is a growing awareness of needing to deal with a range of political, or intellectual registers that kind of insist that the kind of black politics, the politics of the black body, and in particular the politics of the black female body, right, and other sex bodies need to be placed more centrally. So we're almost at the beginning of a kind of intellectual process where these kind of registers are finding themselves more prominent than ever before. Now, there's a kind of rich scholarship, a rich kind of radical feminist scholarship that always placed the kind of female body at the center of the business, particularly in the 1980s, early 1990s, and then for various reasons, because particularly because of the role of the ANC Women's League, the kind of feminist agenda has been, I would say, set back. Even though we've got this wonderful constitution that is perhaps one of the most advanced constitutions, including on women and gender rights, and so forth. So the first point I'm making is that is kind of becoming more central, but I'd suggest that we're probably just at the beginning of this process. For me, the question of surveillance is important. A lot of my research deals with townships and trying to understand how various kind of technologies, both things like the fastest kind of biometric technologies, but also administrative technologies, have been used to kind of create spaces of order and control. And what I was kind of alluding to early on, but I'm only really beginning to do some of this work, is how a lot of these technologies, both administrative and biometric technologies, have been mobilized, or were mobilized, particularly in relation to black women. Okay? It's kind of a difficult area, and I'm quite anxious about myself doing this work. Okay? And I think it's a productive anxiety to have for a man to do the kind of work, the research around black women. I'm not sure where that goes to, but I do think that one needs to work with the kind of anxiety. Because I do think that a large part of the success of apartheid was the way that people kind of reproduce the kind of layers of oppression, how people kind of appropriated these technologies of control, because order was so important. Right? And people bought into the idea of order and all the things that came with order. Now that order was fundamentally disrupted in 1976. Okay? But in fact, I think that often historians have neglected the extent to which an appropriation of some of the ideas of order, including control over one's body, right, in various ways, played an important role in the ability of apartheid to assert control, or a very small minority of the population to assert control over 78% of the population. So that's where I'm getting to with this, and where I'm trying to kind of combine those two. But I'm really only after the starting blocks.
Albert?
Thank you, Noor. I am wondering if you could zoom out of Everton and Sharpeville and comment on the overall historiography of liberation movement, not just in South Africa, but across the continent, if possible. And I am asking you to do that, especially in light of two unfortunate normalcies in liberation historiography, which are hegemonic in two ways. One is the gender hegemony, in which women are expunged and they're only brought to the fore on March 8th, and March 8th happens to be yesterday. But in reality, when the liberation movements bank on their accomplishments to assert power in the present, and the present has no women representation, that places us across African liberation movements, from Algeria to Guinea-Bissau, Namibia, to Eritrea, and South Africa, of course. That's one. The other one is the monopolistic arrogation of the liberation movement to a single organization that is in power, which also places itself out across the continent. If you could please comment on that, I would be grateful.
So my comments are very complete. I think the work that is done, and this, I mean, South Africa is perhaps a good example, because a lot of resources were mobilized in the mid-1990s to kind of critique the dominant historiography, meaning the apartheid historiography, draw on the kind of radical historiography that came out of the 1970s, including the work of Eastern work, but also other radical historians, both the kind of broad political economy and kind of subaltern studies, and to use that as a kind of the intellectual springboard to rewrite the history. So there's a kind of an interesting moment when, I was still an undergrad, but and I, there was also a movement of people's history in the 1980s, which really kind of inspired me to kind of do the kind of work that I'm doing. And there's this hope that in the rewriting of history, that radical historiography, which kind of placed the working class at the center, and increasingly in the 1980s, it was a kind of a cultural turn, which kind of mimicked the cultural turn in the West, okay? Also the influence of feminist studies kind of placed black women more centrally in that literature. That kind of work would kind of frame the new historiography. In fact, many people, including myself, Paul Bonner, and others who kind of came out of that tradition, kind of played along, right? And said, we will contribute to the rewriting of that history. Of course, what ensued was an intense contestation between those of us who wanted to write the history from below and the kind of ambitions of the ANC mobilizing its resources, not only in the production of written histories, but also in kind of recalibrating the heritage landscape. It was intent on producing a very narrow nationalist history, and with nationalism being, amongst other things, a intrinsically masculinist ideology. Okay? And secondly, in the kind of producing of a nationalist history, place the ANC at the center of that history. So kind of producing a teleology rewrote histories of the ANC, right, in that rewriting was always at the center. Even though, as I was saying earlier, the kind of dominance of the ANC only begins to happen in the 1950s. The ANC was launched in 1912, and it was always a kind of a party that what's kind of at the center of the ANC. This applies to other kind of liberation movements as well, although many, many differences, is that the ANC always occupied an important part in the national imagination. Most other parties were either regional parties or ethnically aligned parties. So that as a national liberation movement evolved, the ANC came to occupy this kind of central position as the party that kind of embodied the national aspirations of black people. So what happened post 1994 is that you have the kind of echoing of processes elsewhere. And of course, not only in Africa, you have a similar kind of process in Asia, right? In India, right? Of the Congress Party. Right? You can take China as another example. So this is not peculiar to Africa, but of course, particularly in the case in the 1960s, 1970s, where a particular kind of historiography, a kind of liberation, national historiography, becomes predominant. Let me just kind of end up, so I agree, and I'm kind of amplifying what you're saying. What I'm doing at the moment is kind of, the other people like Imam Dani has been doing this, and other people in Kodisria have been doing the kind of counter-narrative for a long time. But I'm kind of increasingly working with younger people and kind of thinking about things like youth politics and student politics and connecting young scholars to come together and kind of work out the kind of intellectual political registers on their own and kind of rewrite, not only write about contemporary politics, but use the kind of ideas that are kind of produced in these conversations to think about the historiography and look critically at historiography. Because we know, you can take any country, right? I'm speaking about South Africa, we can take any country, you see something similar happening, right? All of these exclusions that happen, the main exclusion being women, but also young people, kind of political parties, arising out of these exclusions is the creation of kind of a dominant narrative, a hegemonic narrative, at the center of which is the ruling party, the center of which often is the kind of key leader, right? Kenyatta, Malemo, Nyerere, Nasser, you take your pick, okay? And it's the same kind of process. Kind of dismantling that is not easy because people are so invested, even where the former ruling parties have been challenged or maybe even out of power, those narratives are so entrenched and kind of also appropriated by people. final point I'll make on this, which is kind of a challenge that I've written about elsewhere, is that particularly in South Africa, many, many black people, when we interview people, they kind of attach their personal narratives to this kind of glorified liberation narrative. But who wouldn't, right? I mean, if you can kind of, you know, stitch your life to a kind of glorious narrative, you know, it affirms oneself, okay? So how does one disarticulate the kind of personal narrative from this kind of collective narrative? It's not easy, but it's a very critical methodological thing to do. I think, by the way, that one of the key answers lies in radical feminism, in kind of disrupting these kind of nationalist narratives and kind of disarticulating, but not completely delinking the personal narrative from the kind of collective narrative, but kind of weaving one's way through these complexities. I think it's hard work, but necessary work.
David, I think this will be our last.
Okay, this last point that you just made I thought was really interesting about how the difficulty of using oral histories to break these nationalist narratives. I want to ask the question about your other major source, which is these commissions of inquiry, where you really have to subject, in a sense, the apartheid state to a sort of a reading against the prose of counterinsurgency in order to craft a narrative that does what you want it to do. What do you find as the benefits and challenges or pitfalls of reading against the counterinsurgency prose of the apartheid state to try and understand what was going on, to try and create a narrative of history from below?
Yeah. So I'd say that two or three things. I think it depends also when one reads. Let's start with there. I think that in the late 1990s, one of the challenges in reading it and kind of using these commissions of inquiry was a kind of instinct to reject everything that's there, okay? Because it's kind of produced by apartheid, by white judges. When one reads the transcripts, you can see the kind of adversarial tone, right? And to kind of simply counterpose a preconceived kind of idea and narrative and reject everything that is there. So I think that's kind of, I would say, broadly speaking, and I'm generalizing, in the late 1990s, 2000s, that would have been instinct. I think now there's a much greater awareness, and, you know, various people, you know, have done quite a lot of work on kind of reading commissions of inquiry. And kind of actually looking at who are the people, who are the judges, right? And making sense of the ideologies. So that kind of very granular reading of the commissions of inquiry that requires the reader, us, the historians, to kind of set aside our kind of present political prejudices and kind of place ourselves in the kind of time when the commissions of inquiry were produced. Kind of try and make sense as far as one can, all the limitations that we understand, okay? And this is what I was saying earlier, it's often people, and I've done this as well, it's easy to read the report of the commission, because that kind of summarizes, gives a neat narrative, okay? It's easy to critique those narratives because, you know, both the kind of ideologies and the kind of conventional construction of narrative, all those things are obviously present and problematic. I think what is required, which is what I'm trying to do with this one, is to go to the transcripts. Again, the transcripts have their own set of problems because, you know, they kind of almost interviews that have been transcribed and sometimes translated, which kind of creates another level of complexity. So I suppose, you know, I would say that, you know, these commissions of inquiry are important, and I should just say, we had a conference about a year and a half ago on the Marikana Commission, and it was fascinating how the question that you're asking was posed there as well. We asked ourselves, right? Here you have a commission of inquiry established by a democratic government having to deal with the most egregious kind of incident in the democratic era. What do we do? Right? And you may know that there's kind of, you know, massive campaigns after the Marikana massacre and critique of the Parliament Commission, the Marikana Commission. And yet we have to subject that commission to the same kind of scrutiny and the kinds of questions that you're asking that one would of the Sidney Commission that looked at the 76 uprising, the Bessels Commission that looked at the Shawbel uprising. And it's tough work, but it's necessary work. But we need to go, I suppose my kind of short answer is, we need to go beyond this kind of cursory reading of the final report of the commission and kind of dig deeper. And then the question someone else asked earlier about the media, and then try to kind of, you know, it's a kind of a triangulation, I suppose, right? And kind of get to the interviews, right? Re-interview people. That's, you know, that's always a challenge, right? I mean, interviews are a challenge. And I have found, maybe make my final point in this way, and I have written about this after in relation to Alexandra. When, you know, for my graduate studies and in my early kind of work that I did in the early 2000s, I found the ability to kind of de-link the personal narrative from the nationalist narrative, the kind of very ANC-centric narrative, very, very difficult. There was probably a time in Alexandria around 2005, 2006, and maybe some of these things around the kind of struggles around, you know, water privatization, you know, social movements. There was a far greater critique emerging of the ANC. So when you begin to interview people around that time, you begin to see people kind of beginning to detach themselves. Okay, not entirely, but beginning to detach themselves from this narrative, which allowed one to kind of ask a set of questions. They didn't kind of artificially break it because it was too complex. And that people kind of are personally invested in a kind of particular narrative. But they kind of open the space for new lines of inquiry in very kind of sympathetic, you know, your careful ways. Much greater now. You kind of interview people now, they kind of, everyone wants to criticize the ANC. Yeah? And to come back to your original point, you do have to be careful. Okay? Just because people are kind of critiquing the ruling party, and that kind of, you know, is interesting, right? You know, they may be detaching themselves so far that it's also producing kind of problematic narratives. Because it is about more about the present than about kind of about the past. So it's complex, but I think in a for me, it's also fascinating. And the questions you ask and everyone, you know, are the things that I'm grappling with. Because things have moved, you know, if you take other parts of the continent, you know, it happened over 4 or 5 decades. It's kind of happening in kind of 10, 15 years. It's kind of, you know, concertinaed, right? And kind of having to deal with all of these issues in a much more kind of dramatic and speedy way.
I want to thank you for attending and thank you very much.